मॉर्निंग
कोचर कल गाना गुड मॉर्निंग का सुन मुकद का सुना दे ड्रग्स के अन्य मुनाद का सुन गान
ड्रग्स के अन्य हीरोइन खुद तमा पाल चुके रहे मैं नाटक करने तमा हूँ
अरे मुकद का सुन दे कोचर कल गान ना मंदे
मंदे गाना रखे उन्होंने डॉक्टर आओ तो इका हमारा इतर वेनो हाँ सामान्य टैकर टेके 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 जागे ना उदय हाउस तमा गान नहीं ගර්ල්ෆ්‍රෙන්ඩ් අපි අපේ කතාවේ ඉස්සරහට එනවා ගර්ල්ෆ්‍රෙන්ඩ් කියනවා මේ බඳින්න බෑ මේක දිගටම තියනවා නම් කියලා ඒක නවත් ගත්තේ නැත්නම් කියලා අපි හරි ප්‍රශ්නයක නිසා මම මේ කොහොමද නවත් ගන්න තමයි ආවේ
එතකොට ඔය ගර්ල්ෆ්‍රෙන්ඩ් කියනකම් කසුන්නෝක ප්‍රශ්නයක් විදියට දැක්කේ නැද්ද
නෑ ඇත්තටම ඉතින් මේ බඳින එක නැත්නම් ඉතින් මට ඇත්තටම මේ ප්‍රශ්නයක් නෑ
එතකොට සල්ලි වියදම් වෙන්නේ එහෙම මුකුත් එහෙම ලොකු ප්‍රශ්නයක් නෑ මේක නිසා
प्लान නවත්තන්න ડોක්ටර් මේ මම නවත්තලා නෑ කවදාවත් මම දැකලා තියෙනවනේ යාළුවෝ නවත්තන්න කියලා ඒගොල්ලෝ කියන කතාව ඒක සික් එක දැන් මටත් කියනවා දැන් මම ගිහින්නම් දැන් හන්දිර දෙනවා ඊරැන්ද කියන එක මේ යාළුවෝ කියන විදියට මේක තනියම කරගන්න බෑ මේක මට බයයි ඇත්තටම මේක කරගන්න මේ ඒකයි ආවේ
එතකොට දැන් ඊයේ ඔයාගේ හන්දිර දෙනකොට මේ ප්‍රශ්න අහම ඔයා මොකද කරේ
हिते අනිම කරගන්න බෑ මේක තමයි මම නම් දන්නේ සමහරු ඉතින් මාසයක් විතර යනවා කියලා මේක වෙන වැඩක් කරන්න වෙන්නේ නැහැ
ඔව්
මේ අනික ડોක්ටර්ස්ලා ගාව දිනවනේ අර බෙහෙත් සෙට් එකක් කතා ගන්න ඒක ගත්තාම ඒගොල්ලෝ හොඳට ඉන්නවා
හා හා හැබැයි ඉතින් ඇත්ත තමයි කසුන් මේක මේ එකක් තමයි බලමුකෝ දැන් තුනක් කියුවානේ වාට හේතුන් වාට මේක මාසයක් විතර ගියොත් ඔයා මොකද කරන්නේ ඇත්තටම ඔය දැනෙන අපහසුතාව තියෙන්නේ දවස් කීපයයි. ඒක තමයි ඇත්ත. හරිද? දැන් දවස් දෙක තුනක් යනකොට ඕක දැනෙන්න අරගෙන ඊට පස්සේ අඩු වෙලා යනවා. සමහර අයට ටිකක් සතියකට විතර පස්සේ සමහරට පොඩ්ඩක් නිින්ද අඩුකමක් තියෙන්න පුළුවනි. හැබැයි එහෙම ලොකු අපහසුතාවයක් නැහැ. දැන් එතකොට දැන් ඔයාගේ යාළුවෝ මේක කරන්න අමාරු කරන්න බැරි දෙයක් කියලා කිව්වනේ. දැන් ඒ යාළුවෝ එතකොට ඊට පස්සේ මොකද මේ බෙහෙත් අරගෙන ඒක නැවැත්තුවද සම්පූර්ණයෙන්ම මොකද උනේ?
ඒ කියන්නේ දෙන්නේ නම් ඔය රට කීල එහෙම නාස්ත ගත්තා අනිත් අය නම් ඉතින් අර බෙහෙත් බොන ගාන්න ගන්නේ නැහැ. ඊට පස්සේ ඉතින් ආයෙත් එනවා
කොහොමද? සමහරවිට කසුන්ට හම්බ වෙලා නැතුව ඇති. නමුත් අපිත් ගොඩක් අයව හම්බ වෙනවනේ. එතකොට මේ වැඩි හරියක් දෙනා ඇත්තටම නවත්තන්න හිතුවම එයාල ඒක නවත්තනවා. හරි? දැන් ඔය හැබැයි නවත්තන්න හිත හදාගෙන නැති අය නවත්තන්න ලොකු උවමනාවක් නැති අය ওই මොන බෙහෙත ගත්තත් නවත්තන්නේ. ඉතින් මේක දැන් ලොකු දෙයක් කියලා කසුන්ගේ ඔළුවට යම් කිසි දෙයක් වැටිලා තියෙනවනේ. දැන් ඕක වැටෙන්න ඇත්ති දැන් ඔයාම කියනෝනේ වාගේ යාළුවෝ කියපු දෙන් කට්ටිය කතා කරන එකෙන් කියලා. ඉතින් උතන පොඩි තියෙනවා මේ කතාව ගොඩනගන්න උත්සාහයක් තියෙනවා මේව පාවිච්චි කරන අය අතරේ සහ විකුණන අය අතරේ. මේක ලොකු දෙයක් කියලා. වට බෑ කියලා. එතකොට ඔයා මොකද කරන්නේ ඔයාට බෑ කියලා හිතුනහම
ගන්නවද?
ඔව්. හරි. එතකොට ඔයා නවත්තන්න උත්සාහ කරන්නේත් නෑ. ඔයා දිගටම ගන්නවා. එතකොට ඒ කාටද වාසි?
පොසත්
වෙනවා. එංගල. හරි. ඉතින් ඒකෙහිඳ දැන් ඔයාම කිව්වා ඔයාට ඊයේ දැනුණ දේ ඔයා ඒකට මොකද්ද කරේ කියලා. ඒ වගේ කතාවක් තමයි මෙතන තියෙන්නේ. ඔයාට අපහසුතාවයක් දැනුනොත් ඔයා ඒකට මොන හරි පිළියමක් යොදන්න පුළුවන්. හැබැයි ඔයා දන්නවා කොහෙන් ගියත් මේක දවස් 3-4යි ඊට පස්සේ මේක අඩු වෙලා යනවා. එතකොට දැන් දැන් අනිත් එක තමයි දැන් මං කසුන්ව පරීක්ෂා කරලා බැලුවානේ. බැලුවාම එතකොට දැන් කසුන්ගේ අපි ඇඟේ අපි බැලනාඩි බැලුවා. හරි ඔයාගේ ඇස් දෙක බැලුවා. දැන් ඒ වගේ බැලුවාම මේ හෙරොයින් නිසා කස් කෙනෙක්ගේ ඇඟේ ඇති වෙන වෙනස්කම් හෝ හෙරොයින් ඇඟෙන් අයින් වුණාම ඇති වෙන වෙනස්කම් වෙන ලොකුවට නම් කසුන්ට නැහැ. හැබැයි කසුන්ට ලොකු වේදනාවක් ලොකු අපහසුාවක් ඊයේ දැනුණා කියලා කිව්වා. ඒක වෙන්නේ කොහොමද? හැබැයි ඔයා ගන්න පැකට් එකක් දවසට තුරු කොහොමද ඒක වෙන්නේ? පැකට් 3-4 ගන්න එක්කෙනාටත් ඒ අමාරු ඔයාටත් ඒ අමාරු.
මේ මට වඩා සමහර විට ඇති අමාරු.
හරි. එතකොට දැන් කසුන්ට නිකන් හිතෙන්නේ නැද්ද මේක පොඩි ඔයාගේ බය නිසාත් ඔයාට මේක ටිකක් මේ කොහොම කරගන්නද කියලා බය හිතේ තියෙන නිසා තමයි මෙහෙම දැනුනේ කියලා. හරි. එතකොට මෙතන නවත්තන්න ඔයාට කිසිම බාධකයක් නැහැ. හරි. මේ මොනා හරි අමාරු තිබුණත් අපි ඒවට මුහුණ දෙමු. හැබැයි හිතේ බය වෙලා වැඩි වැඩේ කරන්න නැතු ඉන්න එක තමයි. Okay, so you saw Kasun when he presented with heroin withdrawal symptoms. Now to address heroin withdrawal, you need to know what withdrawal is. Right? So now what happens in the body is that when we put in a chemical regularly, a chemical that can cause changes in your brain, your body reaches a new homeostasis. So it changes itself with regard to neurotransmitters, the levels, the receptors to accommodate this continuous input of exogenous chemicals. And it reaches a new balance. And then if you take that chemical away or reduce it to a significant degree, your body loses that homeostasis and that gives rise to certain symptoms and signs. But eventually, after a few days, the brain again readjusts and it reaches another homeostasis, another state without the exogenous chemicals. And it balances itself and goes on. Now that is the usual course. Therefore, withdrawal is self-limiting. Generally, a few days to a week, maybe a few symptoms might persist, but it's generally up to 1 week. The only exception is alcohol, and my colleague will discuss alcohol withdrawal with you. But with regard to all the other dependence causing substances, it's self-limiting and they are not dangerous symptoms or signs. They will not put your patient's life at risk. Now, knowing this, these are the drugs of common drugs of abuse. Nicotine, the withdrawal syndrome is more psychological, quite mild. Apart from alcohol, like I said before, all the other withdrawal syndromes are self-limiting and you can just watch and wait and use medication if and when needed. We will go on to that later on. Right, so because we are concentrating on heroin withdrawal in this presentation, let's look at some symptoms. Now, withdrawal in heroin and in any other, except for alcohol, in any of the other withdrawal syndromes, the symptoms and signs, there are a set of known symptoms and signs, but their presentation varies from person to person and the intensity varies. So one person might have one set of symptoms, another person might have that and some additional symptoms. For instance, now these are some of the physical symptoms, physical and psychological symptoms that you see in heroin withdrawal. Most of them are objective ones that you can measure, like in the role play, I said your pulse and when I checked your pupil size, they are normal. So when a person presents you with heroin withdrawal, they generally will tell you, I feel this, this, this and this. But you can actually examine them and see to what degree the physical symptoms are present. That will give you an idea about how bad the withdrawal is and actually whether there is another cause for this person to feel the way that he does. So what can be the other cause? Can they ask questions, Dr. Mahesh? Can they, or can they answer if I ask? Okay, so some of you might be working as GPs or MOPD or in medical wards, and you might have seen patients coming with heroin withdrawal. What are the things that they say? What are the common symptoms?
You can now unmute yourselves and speak.
They say about body pains.
Body aches. Okay.
Lack of sleep, goosebumps.
Okay.
Diarrhea and rhinorrhea.
All right. Okay. So those are the common things. But you will, you know, those of you who have been working with patients would know that the body aches and the lack of sleep are the ones that bother them the most. Right. So, the perception of what is going on in their body actually majorly influences what they feel. Now, in the case of Kasun, who has not actually tried to go without heroin for any, you know, long degree of time, he was sure that he was going to have severe withdrawal symptoms. Now, why is that? When I examined Kasun, there was no change in his pulse rate or his pupil size, so there were no physical symptoms. Yet, he had severe body aches, he had sleep disturbances. Now, that is the part that we need to understand, because we as doctors who work with patients also learn from these patients. And when a patient person comes and says, I have severe pain and I can't sleep and it's terrible, we also bit by bit take that on and accept that as truth. But as doctors, we need to know, actually, is it true? How much of it is psychological? How much is physical? Right? Now, a person's attitudes and beliefs, believing that it's terrible, makes it terrible. Somebody who's not happy to detoxify, go into withdrawal, will hate it. It will be impossible for him to tolerate. Somebody who doesn't want to stop heroin but is forced by the wife or the girlfriend in this case might not have the motivation to go the whole run the whole race and therefore will find withdrawal difficult. Those in different environments, an environment which says withdrawal is nothing, it's not a big deal, just go through it, are likely to suffer less symptoms, for instance, in prisons. You have people who are heroin users, daily users, those who may sometimes use in massive amounts, they go into prison. Do you find them rolling along the ground or screaming or saying, I can't do this? No, they get on with it. They have withdrawal symptoms, but they deal with it. So your perception actually influences a lot of these symptoms when you are withdrawing. And this is true for all the drugs of abuse apart from alcohol. So what is detoxification? Now we use this term. What is detoxification? For somebody who's dependent on drugs, who will have withdrawal symptoms, we might prescribe or do certain things, give certain treatments to help them deal with those withdrawal symptoms. But then what? So detoxification is actually only the first step in a new saga, or new story, or a new journey that they're embarking on. You help them detoxify, and then they go on to maintain abstinence or whatever their goal is. very rarely we might detoxify when they're admitted to hospital. So they have no intention of being abstinent, but for that short duration of time while in hospital, we have to manage their withdrawal symptoms. But otherwise, managing withdrawal symptoms is with the intention of continuing abstinence or reaching abstinence. So if you detoxify, you need to, or not you, but rather the patient needs to have that plan. Otherwise, why should you detoxify? You're wasting money, you're putting a patient through difficult times, and you might actually be teaching them in a way that they are a failure at it, which is another point when it comes to substance, the self-efficacy, or how things affect your belief in yourself and your ability to stop a substance. But that's a story for another time. So, and also in alcohol, when you detoxify, you're putting them at risk of withdrawal seizures and delirium tremens, which can be fatal. There is a mortality rate. Therefore, it is not a good idea to detoxify somebody who's not motivated or who's not ready to take the next step. It's a waste. Okay, now we'll go on to management of withdrawal, psychological support. And I have put that first because that is the most important thing. We, during our practice, maybe because we don't have a long time to spend with the patient, maybe because we don't really know what to say to a patient like that, we take the more comfortable way out of writing a prescription. 4 drugs, 5 drugs, the more we can think of, the better. The longer the list, the better we feel. We give it to the patient, ask them to take it, and then they don't come back. And that's fine. We tell ourselves, yes, they have either, you know, they have now stopped. So our prescription is right, and this is how we will go on with the next 10, 15 patients that we come across. Right? But that is not true. It is possible that they have stopped if they have decided to stop. Like I said before, in that video clip, if you decide to do it, a lot of people do it without medication. They just need that nudge. So maybe coming to you and just talking to you might have done it. It's unlikely your prescription did it, but talking to you, having that contact, would probably have done it. But if not, it's most likely they might have relapsed, because we see after detoxification, if you don't offer psychosocial support, the relapse rate is very high, close to 50%. Maybe more as time goes by, right? So psychological support is what you need to do. And then you can give symptomatic medication. Symptomatic treatment means they have to have the symptoms to treat. It is not very right to prescribe medication for things that you think they might develop if you're not very sure. For example, okay, let's go on to the next one. And when we talk about medication, I'll tell you about it. So you need to also know about the duration. The patient comes and says, this goes on for months. You need to know, no, it doesn't. The actual withdrawal syndrome is 1 to 7 days roughly. Peaks at about day 2, day 3, and then the symptoms gradually grow down. Sleep disturbances may persist. Craving will probably persist, but the other physical symptoms will go down. Right? So you need to tell your patient that, because otherwise they have learned it from their friends who have either not tried or who are dealing them the heroin and, you know, who don't really want them to get out of this. Right. And in that first session, if you give them medication, you also need to know that they need to be motivated, right? So the person who drags, the wife who drags the husband to you, the husband who doesn't want to change his heroin use, is unlikely to be motivated, right? So see whether they are motivated, see whether you can motivate them. Family, friends, professionals can all support. You need to have a plan as to what you do next after detox. You can't just let him go and say, okay, fine, get on with your life. Some people do, and that's perfectly fine. But for some people, they might need a bit of support. And you get their self-efficacy up and you say, now you have done this, you've taken the first step, and so on. Right. Symptomatic management, pain relief, if they have pain. Sleepers, if they have sleep disturbances. Antispasmodics, antihistamines. Now, these are these are things that we tend to prescribe as a list. What I would like you to know is that you don't have to. If they are, you know, eyes tearing up or their nose is dripping, it's not an issue for them, don't prescribe Biritan. If they can deal with their abdominal spasms and their diarrhea, let them deal with this, because you're teaching them an important lesson in self-efficacy by doing that. You are saying you can do this. These are things that you can get over. And it boosts them up, because next time, if they don't stop, they need to go through this again. But they will feel that they can, because they went through it without any issue and they came out the other side fine. So choose the symptoms that are really bothering them. My experience is, if you ask patients first time, they will give you a list, like the list that you gave me. But if you ask them, okay, what are the things that bother you the most? They will most probably say one or two things. Most likely are the joint pains and the sleep disturbances, but maybe a few of the others. And then you address those. Inpatient detoxification, a lot of doctors feel that, that they should admit this patient, but generally the evidence is that it doesn't really work. So in general, we do not admit all patients for detoxification, but if they have very poor social support, if there is polysubstances like alcohol plus heroin, and you don't want them going into alcohol withdrawal in the community, or they have multiple medical comorbidities, or we have repeatedly failed to detox despite good motivation and good psychological support, then you might consider it. And in specialized units, we might use certain medication like clonidine. But the studies show that whatever you use for detoxification, the outcome is almost the same. So whether you use clonidine or some people use tramadol, you know, it doesn't actually make a difference. Relapse rates are almost the same unless you offer psychological support. Then, of course, the relapse rates drop. And this I would, because most of us are GPs who see patients as outpatients, this use of tramadol and pregabalin is rampant now. But you have to remember that these are drugs that can be, that are dependence causing themselves. For instance, tramadol is an opioid. So if you are treating heroin withdrawal, not the opioid, what are you actually doing, right? And pregabalin also has a certain level of dependence, causes dependence. And also when you give this as outpatients, they go and share it with their friends or they sell it. Your prescription goes around. Pharmacies learn about this. So there are a lot of consequences to the actions you take in those 5 minutes, and you have to be careful. Right, so follow-up, I said, you need to give some follow-up. Don't just let them go, maybe one or two sessions. It depends on the person. See what they want, what they need. Right, so to end my presentation, these are some of the challenges that you will face, right? The patient comes and says, I'm having withdrawal symptoms. You see him weekly, he's coming every week with withdrawal symptoms. And you prescribe the same set of medication again. What is happening? Likely he is using, right? But at a lower level. So he says, I'm not using, now I have not used. But if you get him alone away from the family and say, now tell me the truth, I know this, it's not possible. They are used it here and there. So that is the reason for continuing withdrawal symptoms. And then no objective signs, but patient is distressed. You help him with his, you give the psychological input. And also remember, relapses occur. That is not your failure as a doctor, right? That is the nature of this illness. And therefore, you do not have to take it on yourself and think, okay, I'm not a good doctor, it didn't work, right? But if you can give them something to take to their next attempt to abstain, that is more than enough, right? So take home message is this, and I will finish my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you. Medhani, please don't go. We'll have this discussion, so you can be there at the podium while we have discussion. So thank you, Medhani, for that brilliant presentation and how you nicely put the importance of perception in perspective. Thank you very much. So it's now open for discussion. So now you can unmute yourselves and speak up. So if there are any questions, you can now just unmute and ask.
May I make a suggestion?
Diana. Yes, please.
One thing that I want to suggest or ask is, when people come saying adanamman nawattanna ona me teendu karala ave doctor and out to get only medication from you, I have tried telling them, fine, we will start your management tomorrow. Heta enna hari, it's a tactic that I have experimented with, and some people come the next day, some people don't. I don't want to go in detail in this, but I just want to know what Medani might think about that tactic and the benefits or losses or damage or gains.
Thank you, sir. I agree with you, sir. Now, some people think, and most medical professionals think, those who are not in mental health, that you need to catch them and somehow treat them. So if they come to your clinic, wherever you are, even if there's no clinic, they'll bring them, and then we are supposed to treat them, give them medication and make them better. But it doesn't work that way. Like I said, there's no point detoxifying somebody, giving medication, if you're not, you know, if you're not prepared them to take the next step. So maybe asking them the next day is a good way to find out whether they're motivated. And might actually be a good way of weaning out the people who are less motivated. But sir, I would also say that I will, in that first consultation, I would probably not give medication. I agree with you completely. But I would try to work a bit on his motivation and see whether I can get him to at least self-reflect and see where he is. And then I would let him go, to be honest, and let him work that out and come back to me or whoever when he's ready to take the next step.
Thank you. Thank you for that question. Maybe just a little addendum. I mean, you can creatively think of various ways of weaning out the less motivated, making the motivation better, testing the motivation, let the motivation be exhibited to the family. Sometimes family thinks the person is highly motivated, but you find that the person is not. So you can demonstrate the level of motivation to the family. Perhaps you can give medication and ask to come back next week, whether it is successful or not, and then see who comes back. And, you know, so lots of, I think, creative ways. Thank you for that question as well. Any other questions? We can maybe take one more question.
Sir, can I ask a question? I'm from Kakirava, Dr. Asita. I'm dealing with a lot of patients with the help of police and other people who send to me. Sometimes I feel that as clinicians, we can also be demotivated because we don't see much output coming in. So can we share the output from a clinician point of view? What is the your experience? How many patients as clinicians you have seen and treated, and what best that you could do with those? How many people came out of heroin use and other substance abuse use completely or at least by now?
Okay, Medan, you want to? Right. Now, in an audit we did at our clinic in NHSL, we mainly looked at how many of them do come to follow up. Because your question has a little complexity in that. So how many do come out of heroin? I mean, what do you mean by that? Come out for 1 week, 1 month, 1 year, completely stop? Or there are people who have drastically reduced? Is that a positive outcome or not? So we can go to town about indicators of improvement. And I think you need to look at all of that, not just this label he's come out of. I mean, what does it mean that he has come out of? He might use it after 40 years, then he's not a person who has come out of it. So we have to look at it that way. And then once you start looking at it scientifically, immediately you see that you are making a change, right? That is one thing. Other thing, you know, what we have found is that about 30% do come back for the next visit, and with some improvements, changes in our intervention, the percentages rose. So you continue to experiment and look at the differences that you make. You do something new, and then you might detect that people are not interested in, less interested in follow up. You might do something again, and you know. So I think I would encourage you to you know, look at it scientifically, holistically, and continue to. Then the motivation, your motivation will go up, right? We don't have to give just a motivating sentences or utterances here. Anything, Medhani, Jamal?
I would say that what Dr. Rajasuriya said was perfectly right. I would say add that psychological bit to your consultation, because then even though the outcome might not be abstinence 2 weeks after or whatever, but for the next time or whenever they decide to be abstinent, that will be very important. So it might not be something that you can measure, but it is something that will be there in their minds, in their brains. And that is very important. Don't underestimate yourself and your ability to make a difference, and do not judge your ability by the actions of another person.
And do not judge it by the amount of heroin use only.
Yes.
And the duration of abstinence only. I think that's very important. There are two more questions. In primary care setting, how should we follow up these patients after managing trial withdrawal, initial withdrawal symptoms? Could you please brief pathophysiology behind withdrawal? Does it need to do we need to admit IV heroin users for withdrawal management? I think that Medhani, IV users, do we need to admit? And once you have done the initial withdrawal management, what else? Very briefly.
Okay, so IV heroin users, what we need to understand is that only a few are actually regular IV users. Some people use IV heroin on and off, and the majority of use is actually inhaled. Right? So you need to sort of differentiate what the usage is, and also find out whether they actually have significant withdrawal symptoms or not. So there is no guideline saying you must admit IV heroin users. You go with your physical examination, discussion with your with the patient, and you know, the all the other things that I talked about, the support, what sort of environment he is in, and so on. And make that decision. You would, in theory, be looking at more severe withdrawal symptoms if they are IV users. But just remember, you know, the heroin that we get in Sri Lanka is not very pure heroin. You know, it's the purity rate is quite low. So even though they are using it IV, it's quite likely that the withdrawal symptoms are still manageable without with the usual interventions that I talked about. But you will have to do maybe more psychological inputs for them. So it might be an idea to refer to mental health services if it's possible, if you think it's feasible. But if you have a good relationship with the patient, then you are the best person to deal with it. So why not try detoxing him outside in the community if everything else is okay? And then if that fails, then you can either refer or you can get some help from mental health services.
And after the initial withdrawal management?
So also remember, IV heroin users, initial management, even though it's detox, you also have to think about hepatitis C, hepatitis B, HIV, all the other risk factors, TB. So because you are his doctor now, and you're not looking just after his substance, so make sure that you look after all of that. And then maybe a little bit more follow-up might be indicated. Again, the patient depends on the person. So be directed and be led by the person. And things like family interventions and all those things might be more important in this group.
So maybe for the follow-ups, we'll encourage the patient to come with wife, girlfriend, family, and you know, and continue some conversation about, you know, what else now needs to happen in life and that sort of thing. The last question, I think we'll end it here with answering this last question very quickly. The pathophysiology, I will just mention one thing that, you know, heroin is an opioid, so it's an analgesic. So the body gets used to this overdose of analgesics for a long period of time. And then, I mean, it's like you are taking an antihypertensive without high blood pressure. And suddenly, if you stop the antihypertensive, there'll be some increase in the blood pressure because the body is used to it. So just like here, you know, the body is used to an overdose of analgesics for a long period of time. You suddenly remove it, you have lots of pain perception, exaggerated pain perception. And you can apply to other effects as well. But due to time constraints, I think we will stop there. Medhani, thank you very much.